Welcome everyone to the Fenafor Cloud in the field. We are still catching up with everything that we released at Ignite. So thanks again for everyone that already subscribed to the Microsoft Security channel. If you did not, make sure to visit this AKA link that I'm gonna put right now in the bottom of this video. Make sure to click subscribe, hit the bell to get notifications when new episodes are updated. For today, continuing that same sequence, we have someone that's been here before, delivering a presentation about compliance, and she's back now to talk about some of the new things that we released at Ignite when it comes to compliance. So, Ronit, my friend, welcome back.
Thanks, Yuri. It's great to be back.
Absolutely. Great to have you. Finally, we were able to put some time on your busy agenda, so I appreciate that. So at Ignite, we released some updates when it comes to Microsoft Defender for Cloud compliance dashboard. Can you summarize some of those updates, please?
Yeah, absolutely. And in fact, I have even a couple of slides that can help describe the updates that we released.
Awesome. Let's do it.
Yeah, so some of the exciting enhancements that we released at Ignite for compliance are all about giving our Microsoft Defender for Cloud customers the ability to manage a broader range of their compliance requirements. So we've released elements of shared responsibility, giving customers more information about how Microsoft as a platform, Azure as a platform, meets its part of the shared responsibility controls. And in that way, customers can understand the full compliance requirement, what the platform needs to do and what we do, and also what the customer needs to do for the customer part of the shared responsibility. And this really does help give customers transparency into Microsoft's compliance state for these controls. In addition, we have a really exciting new release of what we call manual control management. So if up until this point, customers could only manage compliance requirements that were automated with assessments in Defender for Cloud that actually assess their resources, we now have the ability to actually manage manual requirements as well. So these are requirements in compliance standards that can't necessarily be automated, but that still need to be met in order to meet those compliance requirements. And customers can provide evidence to show and attest how they're meeting those controls. And the idea is that then customers can prepare an audit report covering all the requirements for a standard. So both the automated controls and those manual controls. So just to kind of show a little bit about what we've done here, the compliance offerings tab that we now have available in, through the compliance dashboard, basically shows for all Azure services, what is their compliance status? And this will help customers, approve certain services based on compliance requirements that they have. So that's one exciting thing. Another element, again, as we said, we now have greater visibility into all the requirements for each compliance control. So this includes a really good sort of detailed overview for what are the requirements for that control. And then we have the Microsoft actions that we show here, which is what Microsoft as a platform does to meet the shared responsibility part of the control that is owned by the platform, in addition to all the customer actions that they need to take to meet those requirements. And finally, as we said, those manual controls. So for the compliance requirements that can't be automated or aren't automated, then customers have a way to manually attest to compliance with those controls and then provide evidence so that they can use that information, that evidence to go to compliance audits and create reports for that. So those are the main things there. In addition, we've also announced the Microsoft Cloud Security Benchmark at Ignite, which replaces the Azure Security Benchmark that we had previously.
This is actually a lot of cool things there. Love the attestation. This is something that we heard a lot from customers that they would like to do that. So I'm very glad that this is available now. Now, talking about this replacement of Azure Security Benchmark to the Microsoft Cloud Security Benchmark, is that was just a renaming, or there are way more changes behind the scenes to really enhance this new baseline?
Well, so the idea here of the Microsoft Cloud Security Benchmark is actually to take the Azure Security Benchmark as a base, but extend it to multi-cloud. So if previously the Azure Security Benchmark was a set of controls based on industry compliance standards and best practices, and defining best practices for how to be the most secure in Azure, then the Microsoft Cloud Security Benchmark takes those same best practices, the same security controls, and applies them to multi-cloud as well. So we already support application of the security benchmark controls to AWS in addition to Azure. And we provide in the documentation for customers for how to meet all of these control requirements in their AWS environment as well, in addition to their Azure environment. And our compliance dashboard enables customers to manage these requirements centrally for both Azure and AWS right now. So again, what we basically did was we took our controls, our ASB controls, extended them a little bit, but also mapped them to existing AWS assessments in Defender for Cloud, along with developing new AWS assessments to increase the coverage, right? To provide more coverage for those compliance controls by implementing them for AWS. Customers, again, can now manage all of those requirements across clouds in that single pane of glass, the single dashboard. And we've auto-enabled the Microsoft Cloud Security Benchmark for all AWS accounts in the same way that it's auto-enabled for Azure accounts. So that's what we have so far. And then next step here is to extend that to additional clouds, starting with GCP, for which we have assessments. So we're going to be extending that benchmark next to GCP, and also providing more coverage for AWS and for Azure always.
So it's great to see that we are expanding the compliance dashboard throughout multi-cloud environments, start with AWS and coming next GCP, because Defender for Cloud is a full multi-cloud platform. It supports AWS and GCP. Everything goes to a single dashboard, so you can manage the security posture of across multi-cloud. Now, having said that, what really are the purpose of adding those manual actions to the compliance standards, and how Defender for Cloud customers can use them?
Yeah, so I think as you mentioned earlier, Yuri, right, one of the biggest requests we've had from customers is to be able to manage all the requirements for a compliance standard, right? Up until this point, we only had the assessments that were able to actually evaluate deployed resources, and in that way provide basically signals for how customers are meeting compliance requirements. But many of the compliance requirements can't be automated. They can't just go and kind of evaluate deployed resources in order to understand what the compliance state is. Many compliance requirements require documentation or different types of evidence about how the customer environment is actually meeting those requirements. And so the great advantage of having these manual controls is that now customers can manage both the automated controls, the automated assessments, but also all of the additional compliance requirements that can only basically be met by providing offline evidence. And in that way, customers can manage all of the requirements for a compliance standard in that one compliance dashboard in Defender for Cloud.
That's great. Makes a lot of sense. Now, do you have a demo to show us how those things work?
Absolutely. I'd love to show the demo. Yeah, so here we have the updated regulatory compliance dashboard in Defender for Cloud. As you can see, we now have the Microsoft Cloud Security Benchmark replacing the Azure Security Benchmark. And as we said, the advantage of this is while we have the same set of controls that define security best practices for a cloud environment, we now have assessments that analyze your Azure deployed resources for these controls, but also assessments for AWS deployed resources for these controls. So basically, customers can manage all of these security best practices in a single dashboard in order to meet their security best practices across clouds. And of course, these recommendations behave as all of the security recommendations work for AWS. So customers can go directly into each one of these different assessments that help them meet those security controls. They can understand exactly which resources are unhealthy and healthy that are deployed in AWS. And of course, we give them the detailed remediation steps for how to resolve all of these issues and how to become compliant with these security best practices. So that's kind of the exciting update for the Microsoft Cloud Security Benchmark. And as we mentioned before, anytime MDC customers onboard their AWS accounts, then this benchmark will be automatically assigned to their accounts so that we can start evaluating their environment according to the benchmark controls right away.
Now, Ronit, I think that one of the questions that comes up frequently is, from the customer perspective, there is nothing that they need to do. Customers that were using Azure Secure Benchmark, which was the default for the Fenafor Cloud, nothing needs to be done, right? We'll be automatically updated for this, so there is no new deployment, anything is done behind the scenes, correct?
Exactly. So for the Azure environment, the exact same Azure policy initiative that's defined as the Azure Security Benchmark is still running on the customer environments. Nothing needs to be changed, nothing needs to be updated, and the assessment should be the exact same value. This is really just kind of adding that new value for those AWS accounts to start analyzing all of the AWS accounts and resources according to these standards as well. So nothing needs to be done by customers in order to adopt this change.
Now, for a new customer, brand new environment, he just onboarded the Fenafor Cloud.
So what a new customer would see, basically the same as before, right? They would get the automatic assignment of the benchmark to evaluate their Azure resources. And it's actually still called Azure Security Benchmark Compliance Initiative now for their Azure environment. So if you go and look in the policy portal, you'll still see the Azure Security Benchmark Initiative, which is sort of the Azure portion of the multi-cloud, the Microsoft Cloud Security Benchmark.
Okay, I think that helps a lot, because I think that some customers, they were looking for this initiative, and that's not the case.
That's right. We're still calling it Azure Security Benchmark for now. We may change the name eventually, but again, because that's the Azure portion of it that's implemented in policy, that is still the Azure Security Benchmark. And then in managing AWS, you'll see the Microsoft Cloud Security Benchmark for AWS and the specific assessments that are applicable to that.
Oh, that's great. There is any way, just to wrap up before, because this is something that comes up, in the portal, if customers want to submit feedback about new standards, can they do that from the portal, or they should use like user voice to do that?
Customers can submit that feedback either way. We look at both. There is a feedback request that comes up here in the dashboard automatically when it's opened. Right now, I've kind of closed it because I already submitted my feedback, but anytime a customer navigates to the compliance dashboard, they'll see that request for feedback. That's a good place to go and let us know what you think about how things are working today, what's working for you, what isn't, and additional standards that the customers might want to see in this dashboard.
Perfect. And I'm going to put the link here for the user voice, aka
sure.
Link below, so y'all can submit ideas as far as standards. We have a team that look at that feedback, and we'll funnel to Ronit and her team to evaluate the request.
That's right. And then we can show a little bit about what we were talking earlier about the manual controls and the additional controls we were talking about. So looking at a standard such as ISO 27001, if previously anytime we had controls that couldn't be automated, then we would just have those grayed out, as you may recall, right?
Yeah,
there was nothing that customers could
do
with those. So for example, for human resources security, there's really nothing we can do to analyze your resources to find out if you're meeting human resources security,
mm-hmm.
right? Even though it's an ISO 27001 requirement. But now we've added these manual controls, which are basically all of the actions, the manual actions, that can be taken in order to meet these ISO requirements. So for example, there's a requirement to clear personnel with access to classified information. Customers can go ahead and open this kind of manual control. They can see that there are resources or subscriptions that are not attested. So nobody is attested to these yet. By the way, they default to just not attested. We don't default to failing. Mm-hmm. We default to kind of a non-attested state, which doesn't impact your compliance score. But if I do want to attest, then I can go ahead and select a subscription. These are managed on the subscription level, and I can go ahead and click attest. And then I have this interface here where I can provide details such as the compliance state. So this is now compliant, or else maybe it's not compliant and I want it to call out and show that it's failing. And then I can provide the date of compliance, the expiration date, and then implementation details. So this is where we can provide information for how we're meeting this control and even add a link to evidence. So I might put in here information for how my personnel are cleared, and then add some description for the evidence, right, and provide a link. So this might be a documentation, for example, showing how we're clearing personnel for access to classified information. I can provide a link here to a doc like that, and then just click on add evidence. Once I've entered all this information, then I can do create, and that means I've created an attestation for this control.
This is beautiful. This is going to help so much. We heard so what you are saying is that there is no more gray items. Everything is, you are able to create those attestations manually?
Yeah, so basically everything we've mapped to all of the actions you need to take to meet these requirements, whether they're automated or manual, and you can go ahead and address those as you'd like to, right? Again, we're not going to show as failing to begin with in case customers don't want to address these, but if they do, then they're able to do that and address every one of the controls. And then, of course, I have a bunch of controls that might have both automated assessments and manual actions, right? Some things like segregation of duties, for example, is going to have both kind of automated parts and manual parts. And we provide all of those actions for what customers need to take, right? If we click on the control details, we have the full details for what is required for this control, and then all of your actions. So again, some of them are automated, some of them are manual. This reflects exactly those actions that you need to take. And then the other piece that we talked about before was the Microsoft action. So this provides transparency into what Azure as a platform does to ensure that we meet this ISO control. And we really have some very kind of detailed information here for what Azure does and how it's implemented. And this can also be used for audits when customers need to meet compliance requirements.
Ronit, this is absolutely fantastic. I'm so glad that we reached that point. This is gonna unblock so many scenarios. It's awesome. And I think that there were so many things that we released at Ignite that we didn't emphasize enough how much improvement we had on this dashboard. So I'm glad that you took the time not only to share what's new, but also demonstrate that, because I don't think a lot of people are aware about all these changes, and it's just absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, that's great. And of course, you know, we're looking for your feedback, everybody's feedback on this, what's working, what isn't. So reach out, let us know how you're using it and what we can do to improve.
Absolutely, Ronit. Thank you very much again for your time. Amazing release. Congratulations for you, for the entire team, for this great milestone. And everyone, please make sure to utilize, send feedback in the user voice or in the video comments. Make sure to participate. These all chains were based on your feedback. So great work on it. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Yuri. See you again next time.
All right, everyone. That's a wrap for today's episode. Stay tuned. We have more updates post Ignite in the next episode. See you soon.